Hello, this is Rob at practicalprecision.com. In this video, we look at designing and modeling a kinematic mount, one of the most useful and powerful tools in precision machine design and optomechanical engineering, in CAD using SolidWorks. You can download this model and learn more about designing custom kinematic mount at practicalprecision.com/model. A kinematic mount works on the principle that any two rigid bodies have 6 relative degrees of freedom between them. 3 translations, and 3 rotations. Introducing a point of contact between the two bodies eliminates one of these degrees of freedom, as in a ball on a surface. 2 points eliminates 2 degrees of freedom, as in a ball in a V-groove. And 3 points eliminates 3 degrees of freedom, as in a ball in a trihedral socket. By combining these elements in different configurations with no more than 6 points of contact, a kinematic mount positions and orients two bodies relative to one another with very high stability and repeatability. Constraining fewer than 6 points allows precision motion in the remaining degrees of freedom. More than 6 points overconstrains the assembly, introducing distortion, instability, and uncertainty. This is a Maxwell-style kinematic mount. For clarity, I've left out a lot of the details that would be in a real application, just so that we can focus on the details that make it a kinematic mount. A Maxwell-style clamp uses 3 balls and 3 V-grooves radiating from a common center to establish 6 points of contact that fully locate the two bodies relative to one another. In this design, the ball is press-fit into the top plate so that it can't move, but the combined top plate and ball is free to rotate about the center of the ball on the 2 points of contact with the V-groove in the bottom plate. In some applications, one or more of these balls will be replaced with a ball end screw. Turning the screw will adjust the relative position of the ball to the top plate, changing the orientation of the top plate relative to the bottom. If 2 of the balls are replaced by adjustment screws, it's even possible to get a relative adjustment in about two axes. So you can have a tip-tilt system, although it's not quite as intuitive as if they were in a right-angle arrangement. If all 3 balls are replaced by ball and screws, it's even possible to adjust the spacing between the plates without changing the orientation. Depending on the orientation of your mount, the magnitude of the load it will carry, and any external loads, such as shock and vibration, you'll need a mechanism to positively load the kinematic mounting components against each other so that they don't separate. In this case, we're using 3 simple extension springs located midway between each support. Preload can be a critical part of your design. There can be a delicate balance between sufficient locking force to hold the mount together against the combined loads, and excessive force that significantly deforms the components, defeating the purpose of using a kinematic mount in the first place. Preload mechanisms are one of the topics we cover in detail on practicalprecision.com. As I mentioned at the beginning of this video, you can download this model at practicalprecision.com/model and freely use it in your own work. Let's look at the construction of the model and how to easily adapt it to different applications. The model uses top-down design so that we can make changes in one place in the assembly, and those changes will propagate down to the components. That place is the layout component, which is the first component in the assembly tree. The layout contact sketch lets you control the basic footprint of the mount. You can change the diameter of the circle that the supports lie on, and you can change the angle between the supports. The equilateral triangle layout is the most common one you'll see for a Maxwell mount. It maximizes the usable area, is very stable, and can be less sensitive to transient thermal effects due to its symmetry. But in some applications, there can be practical reasons for changing this. The most common reason is that an equilateral layout simply won't fit in the space that's available. So that's changing the layout. This is as simple as editing the diameter and the angle dimensions. And everything else changes accordingly. We may also want to change the ball diameter and the contact angle with the V-groove. We can make those changes using the contact cross-section sketch. The ball diameter and the contact angle could be infinitely variable, just like the spacing and the angle between the supports are. But as a practical matter, precision balls are only readily available in discrete diameters, as are tools for machining smooth surfaces at particular angles. So in the model, we have a fixed number of ball diameter and contact angle combinations, with diameters ranging from 6 to 10 millimeters and angles of 100 to 135 degrees. So we're going to change from currently at 6 millimeters, 135 degrees, to 10 millimeters, 120 degrees. You'll notice that regardless of the ball diameter and the angle, we maintain a half millimeter offset between the center of the ball and the bottom flat of the top plate. Since the ball is press fit into this hole, that just ensures that the widest part is making contact with the hole and that we get a press fit. Similarly, on the bottom, we have a fixed half a millimeter distance between the contact points between the ball and the V groove and the top of the plate. And again, half a millimeter from the bottom of the ball to the bottom of the groove. And that just accounts for manufacturing tolerances. How do you determine the right contact angle and diameter? This is a critical aspect of your design, affecting the performance, stability, and operating life of the mount. There are at least three considerations in designing the kinematic interface. Now, one of the disadvantages of a kinematic mount is that we are supporting whatever combination of design load and external load that there is on at most 6 points, and they are points, not pads. That does result in very high contact stresses that we call Hertzian stresses. Contact stress is a function of the geometry and the load. What's an acceptable level depends on the material properties of the components. The main variable you have to play with is the diameter of the ball. The larger, the lower the stress. For smooth, linear operation and long life, the ball needs to be able to slide easily over the contact points. That's a function of friction and all that normally entails, but also of geometry, in particular the steepness of this angle. You can imagine as the contact angle gets steeper and steeper, you could reach a point where under the operating load, the ball could actually wedge in place and bind. But steeper angles also have benefits. They're more resistant to lateral loads. If the ball does become unseated due to shock, vibration, or other external load, it'll more readily fall back into place. And overall, the repeatability is higher with steeper angles. So in addition to the first order design concern of does it fit, and designing a preload mechanism that performs its function without introducing excessive deflection, we also have the related and sometimes contradictory design parameters of contact stress, friction and freedom of movement, and stability. Visit practicalprecision.com/model to find additional help and resources for designing a kinematic mount that satisfies all of these, to download this CAD model and others, and to sign up for a course in kinematic mount design with me, Rob, at Practical Precision. If you found this video and the CAD model helpful, please like it below. It will help others like you to find it too. And subscribe for more videos on precision machine design and optomechanical engineering.